गुड आफ्टरनून, नमस्कार सभी को. आई वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन दिस नेशनल वेबिनार विच इज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय आयुष दर्पण फाउंडेशन देहरादून इंडिया ऑन एन ओकेजन ऑफ नेशनल आयुर्वेदा डे. आजादी का अमृत महोत्सव के अंतर्गत इस नेशनल वेबिनार में आप सभी का बहुत बहुत स्वागत है. यहाँ पे उपस्थित सभी एक्सपर्टाइज, जो भी सारे डॉक्टर्स है, वैद्यास है, सभी इमिनेंट पर्सनालिटीज है, उन सभी का भी मैं यहाँ पर बहुत बहुत स्वागत करती हूँ. और सबसे पहले तो धन्वंतरी वंदना से हम इस वेबिनार का आरंभ करते हैं. तो हम लोग भगवान धन्वंतरी का यहाँ पर नमन करते हैं वर्चुअली, और उसके बाद सत्र का आरंभ करेंगे. तो आई वेलकम यू ऑल.
शंखं चक्रं जलौकां दधतमृतं घटं चारुदौर्भिश्चतुर्भिः सूक्ष्मं स्वच्छातिरुद्यं शुकपरिविलसनं मौलिमम्बोज्जनेत्रं कालाम्बोद्योज्ज्वलाङ्गं कटितटविलसश्च चारुपीताम्बराढ्यं वंदे धन्वंतरिं तव निखिल गदमिव प्रौढदावाग्निलीलम्.
So, by praying the Lord Dhanvantari, I welcome you all in this national webinar. I especially welcome with the KS Dhiman sir, MS PhD professor, Shalakitantra department, PHU, Varanasi. Sir is former director general, CCRS, Ministry of Ayush, Government of India. I heartily welcome Dr. Shanta Kumari ma'am, who is the chief physician and MD in the group of Matha Ayurveda Hospitals, Kerala. I heartily welcome another speaker of the session, with the Kunjal Bhatt, Associate Professor, J.S. Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, Nadiad, Gujarat. And I heartily welcome our dear Dr. Nisar Ali Khan, sir, who is Associate Professor in the Chalakyatantra Department, Government Ayurved Medical College, Nanded, who is as a co-chairman of this session. And our moderator, Dr. Rajendra Dhate, sir, who is Professor in the Department of Chalakyatantra in Dhanvantari Ayurved Medical College, Udgir, Maharashtra. So I welcome all of you, all the dignified personalities present over here, all the Vedyas who are watching this show on Facebook also. And as I already told that this webinar is organized on an occasion of this National Ayurveda Day, Azadi Ka Amrut Mahotsav Ke Antargat, and specially Ashtang series hum log yahan par chala rahe hai. So aaj hamara ye fourth session hai, which is on the Urdhvanga, that is the Chalakyatantra. And so now, without wasting much time, because we are really eager to listen all our speakers who are the expertise in their areas. So I welcome all of you once again, and I hand over the session towards our moderator, Dr. Dhate sir. So welcome, Dr. Dhate sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much. I firstly welcome all the honorable guests, all the speakers and chairmen, and the delegates, respected professor, HODs, and my colleagues and dear students. I also welcomes all the participants. Now let's start the today's first session. The topic of this session is Chalakyatantra in general practice. For this session, we have an eminent speaker, honorable professor Vaidya Kartar Singh Dhiman sir. Here is no need to introduction. for Dhiman sir, as he is a dynamic personality of the Ayurveda, especially for the Shalakya Tantra. But as a part of introduction, I introduce the Honorable Professor Dr. Dhiman sir. He is assumed the charge of Director General of Central Council for Research in Ayurveda Science under the Ministry of Ayusha. With effect from 9th March 2015, he is highly accomplished academician, Ayurveda practitioner, researcher, and administrator with a distinguished career spanning over 2.5 decades in reputed Ayurvedic organizations like IPGT and RA and Gujarat Ayurveda University, Jamnagar. And also he held the additional charge of the post of Director General, Central Council for Research in Unani Medicine. Professor Vaidya K.S. Dhiman holds a PhD in Ayurveda Shalakya from SSU Varanasi and MD Ayurveda Shalakya from Gujarat Ayurveda University, Jamnagar, Gujarat, India. He is specialized in the field of research Ayurveda, Ayurvedic ophthalmology. He has proven record of scientific contribution with sufficient published work to his credit. He is also the author of 5 books and had authored many research bulletins, technical reports, course material, and monographs. Under his guidance, 9 students have received a PhD till date, and more than 25 students received MS Ayurveda Shalakya. He is also a life member of different professional scientific societies like TAS, India, RAP, and NEMA. Professor Vaidya K.S. Dhiman is a chief editor, board member of different peer-reviewed national and international scientific journal. He had opportunity to chair session of chairman and co-chairman of many national and international conferences, workshop, etc. Professor Vaidya K.S. Dhiman visited Milan, Italy to deliver a keynote address in the first international Congress of Ayurvedic Medicine and also represented Ministry of Ayush, Government of India in Sweden and Levita for participating in the Ayurveda event organized by the mission in Scotland, Sweden and Ayurveda conference in Latvia and visited Germany as a member of the delegation led by the Honorable MOS Ministry of Ayush for participating in the second European World Ayurveda Congress to Germany. For this session, we have Chairman Honorable Vaidya P.K. Shantakumari Ma'am, MD Ayurveda. Now I request to Honorable Professor Vaidya Dhiman sir to deliver the lecture to us. Professor Vaidya Dhiman sir.
Thank you very much. But my brief introduction is, I am still a student of Shalakya Tantra. My pranam to Dr. P.K. Shantakumari ji. I am very happy to see you after a long, you are also attending the same conference. Dr. Shantakumari ji, please accept my namaskar and pranam. Thank you very much for inviting me. Today I am busy with the examination of MD final year, MS final year students, and I could skip a few minutes to be present with you. I am very sure that you were trying me to protect me since morning, Dr. Shilpa, but in the OPD complex there is a very less mobile connectivity. Sorry for your inconvenience. You had a message from my home to me through and through. It shows your enthusiasm. I always feel very happy to be with my colleague teachers and share my views on the subject of Shalakya Tantra. Friends, Shalakya Tantra in general practice, if I am not mistaken, then in general practice, a lot of role is being played by the Shalakya Tantra. And if we see very meticulously and go through the Ayurveda literature and follow the dictums of our acharyas and advise the patients accordingly, a lot can be done in the general practice in Shalakya Tantra. There are many issues. I tell you from ENT viewpoint, allergic rhinitis, no treatment is available. Only levocitrazine or cetirizine supplements are being given, and patient is asked that you have to live with this. Now in Banaras Hindu University, I am attending patients of allergic rhinitis who come with that. We have been told by the modern side hospital that you have to live with this. No, Ayurveda has a very potential role in treating allergic rhinitis. Same way, discharging ear, Karan Srav. So, you know, patient for years together, patient run from post to pillar for ear discharge. Our treatment procedure is simple, Karan Dhupan. If we have a proper instrument for Karan Dhupan, by two or three applications of Karan Dhupan, if we could make the Dhupan Dravya to reach in the middle ear, we can keep the ear dry. And if we follow Shirastha Snan, means you are to keep the ear dry. And if you apply with a probe stick, cotton probe stick, the kshar tail or like dopant drugs on the perforation, and this is a very simple procedure under direct vision, it can be applied. So you can do a wonder. And in general practice, pratishay is the very common disease we come across. And many of the general practitioners are surviving on general fever, cold, cough, and all that. Likewise, throat problems, likewise tonsillitis, likewise gingivitis. I think these simple things which the general practitioner come across, if we prepare our graduate in a very nice way, that these are the simple things for which patient will be coming to you. What will be your approach? What is the exact approach? What I have learned from my seniors like Dr. P.K. Shantakumari and many others, I may tell you, in throat and in oral cavity problems, never forget to treat the GIT, treat the intestinal problem, treat the stomach problem, treat the amalpitta, ama, treat the agnimandya. If you treat simultaneously, then you will get results. So this approach of Ayurveda in general practice should be, it should not be that you have a throat irritation, you take these gargles of betadine. No, a simple gargle of rock salt, hot water, honey, and curcuma longa, haldi, a simple can be made by the patient at home. And this lukewarm, this gargle daily, twice a day, two time brushing a day, keeping the oral cavity healthy, you can, but simultaneously treating the amalpit or agni mandya or whatever GIT problem is there. So I see a lot of potential, and in my viewpoint, in internship part of the training, and we must have this this interaction with the interns, what you will encounter regarding Shalakya in your general practice, what will be your approach, epistaxis, if it is an anterior epistaxis, how will you diagnose, just pinching nose for 5 minutes, no bleeding, it means it's anterior. What is the site? This is the anterior lower third of the vestibular area. This is the site. You can see the ulcer. You apply medicine, keep the area moist, and don't let it irritate it time and again. You will treat it. If the cause is rhinitis or sinusitis, you treat it simultaneously. Very simple. Very simple. And these simple things has to be taught to the students during internship, what they are going to do. I think a lot of potential is there. Even in the outbreaks of conjunctivitis, a general practitioner has a role. I am showing you this eye drop. This is nothing but trifla. If you add the half same equal quantity of honey into it. This is the eye drop which can be used for 3-4 days. No cost. It costs patient less to the patients. It is freshly prepared. Ask patient, given a 2 ml to 3 ml in quantity, and with half of the honey and half of the triphala quark. This is a simple drop which can be used in the epidemics and routine practice also.
Sir, you are muted.
Ocular surface inflammatory conditions. Parishek, simple triphala, yashtimadhu, lodhra. In raktaj problem, you go for lodhra. In tridoshas, you go for triphala. In if it is a pitta, you can go with milk also. Diluted milk also with yashtimadhu, him or fant also. So these are the very simple procedures which can be adopted in. But student has to be made aware and they have to be trained. And I think a lot of potential of Shalakya is there in general practice, and we should not ignore. But as a teacher of Shalakya, it's our prime duty. We should educate the outgoing students during their internship, because in the routine BMS third year, they have to learn everything, whatever is the in the syllabus to pass the examination. But in internship, if we do this endeavor, take a little of the trouble and have an interaction with the students, what you are going to encounter and what you, how you can manage, what is the Ayurvedic line of treatment. See, no doubt somewhere we need to go for some modern medicines also. I tell you, if a patient having pratishaya or throat problem and come with acute pain in the ear, and if you have trained the student to see the eardrum, if it is red bulging, it means it is going to perforate in one day or two. If antibiotic is started and decongestants is started, immediately we can check the perforation, and if perforation is checked, we have avoided a lot of hell to the patients, which he has to follow for years together to get that perforation healed. Likewise, if you come across a corneal ulcer, what is the line of treatment? If it's an infected corneal ulcer, if patient is coming for the first time to the doctor, give a hydratic, give an antibiotic ointment, and send the patient to the higher center for treatment. So this, what is the role of a practitioner in Shalak, in general practice, and what is the role of Ayurvedic person, that role, and when to send the patient to a proper place. I think in when we sit in the Shalakya OPD, many patients come for earwax. Simple procedure is there, snehanam, vilayanam, and aharanam. So students should learn like this in Ayurveda. You have to, if it is a dry wax, snehanam, you put oil and give a hot fermentation, but that hot fermentation should be dry, because water is the enemy of the ear. So it should be dry. So dry fermentation, if it is given, then it is melted, and the melted wax can be removed very, very gently and smoothly in the next visit. So likewise, you see the simple, small problems for which patient has to go to a specialist. And you know, in the remote areas where the specialists are available, far off places. So how much you can save and how much help you to the patient you can do this way. I think our subject of Shalakya Tantra has a lot of role in general practice. And we can diagnose, we can treat, and we can refer the patient well in time to the center, higher center. We can avoid many of the miseries which, as a complication of very simple problems, patient has to face in the coming days. So this way, I take excuse. I wanted to speak more, but I have to be there in the examination shortly. Viva is going to start. Thank you very much for inviting me, Dr. Shilpa. Keep it up, and I wish best of luck to you. And you complete your job, and I will take a feedback from you later on after you complete your job. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for a knowledgeable, helpful, and valuable guidance to us and to the practitioner also. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, in spite of being very busy, sir has given time to us. Abhi hum log chairman madam ko invite kijiye. That is, sir.
For this session, we have Dr. P.K. Shantakumari, ma'am. She is MD Ayurveda. She has completed PG in Chalukya from 1982 onwards up to the 2014, 32 years working in the Department of Chalukya Tantra in various Ayurveda colleges in Kerala. Retired as a professor and HOD from Government Ayurveda College, Thiruvananthapuram. She published the books, textbook of ophthalmology in Ayurveda and Netra Samrakshanana, recipient of first Atharya Award, Best Doctor Award, instituted by the Government of Kerala. Selected as a Guru by Rashtriya Ayurved Vidyapeeth, honored as a legend Chalukya by National Association of Chalukya, founder of Matha Ayurved Hospital Kerala, now working as a chief physician and managing director, Matha Group of Ayurveda Hospital in Kerala. I request to Honorable Vaidya P.K. Shantakumari, ma'am, to give concluding remark on this session. Please, ma'am.
Yes, hello. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay. Then really I am highly pleased to be with you in this very happy occasion, and especially to see Dr. Dhiman. We are friends for a long period, and I was listening her words, which was highly encouraging to the young doctors and also the PG scholars and the UG completed doctors. Really, this is a very interesting topic, and in my experience for the last 40 years, I have seen so many simple cases coming to general doctors. Some cases of Chalukya coming to general doctors for the treatment. Main among them are really this rhinitis or sinusitis or headache. I think Dhiman has misread, I don't know, headache or different types of shirasuela is very common symptom. And coming to Ayurveda in search of treatment in our place. And it is very high, very easily treatable in Ayurveda. Only thing is we have to diagnose it on the basis of Ayurvedic theory, whether it is Vataja. Then easily go for Snehapanam or this Shirabhyangam or Brahmana Nasyam. That will solve the problem. If it is Kapha dominant, we can give Virajana Nasyam and some Kavashamana, this Abhyangatailam like that. It will give them very good results. And so that also is a very hopeful area in Chalukya for the general practitioners. And another area is the sinusitis. That is most often misunderstood and related to different types of headaches. And there also there is high level scope for general practitioners. In most of the cases, they need some Kavashamana in oral medications and also Virajana Nasya. It will give good results. Bhakti Akshadatre Adiganam, Varana Adiganam, these are very, very, very effective. And if it is infected situation, we can give gulgulu tiktaka, kaisara gulgulu, etc. Also has seemed to be very effective. I have seen patients suffering from sinusitis for about 20 years, 25 years like that, and done sinusectomy sucking off the fluid frequently like that. And that also can be solved by OP medicines and OP level treatments by a general physician. That is the fact. Then like that, ear problems. Doctor has already mentioned about it. Like that, sometimes of hearing related problems and also vertigo related problems also can be handled by general physician easily. Vertigo is anyway some vada dominant associated with the kapha. We have seen that in the rasachaya, among the symptoms, Brahma is the main symptom. They say Raucha, Brahma, Shosha, Glani, Shabda, Asakishnava. These are all the symptoms we can see in vertigo. So we can handle that case in such a way to solve the problem with Vada Shamana, Dasamula, and Badardar Vedi. That type of preparation which is having an Ayopaya, that type of preparations are very effective, I have seen, for the treatment of this type of problems. So like that, which is very common in local areas, in their particular areas, they have to identify it and find solution for them. Sometimes the problem in one area or which is in Kerala may not be the problem in Rajasthan. That may not be the problem, main issue in Punjab. So we had to identify the locally important session with problems and be ready and be prepared to solve that. That is my advice. And not to study all the things and be an expert, because there are situations which can be handled only by an expert. Then one more area is that is the diagnosis section. We can identify or diagnose a general case. For example, general intestinal problems can be diagnosed by examining the oral cavity. Or by simply viewing the conjunctiva, we can say that there is anemia. Or like that, there are so many things. That also is an important area where is like not specialist and seeing this allergic cases, we can on the other way we can refer to a general physician or we can handle that case successfully. So the teachers in the colleges also has to give importance to such an area and give them practical training how to handle simple allergic conditions in home general practice and make them confident to handle that case. And anyway, I give all the wishes for the success of this seminar, and I think it will be highly beneficial in sense after this seminar. Thank you all. Thank you once again for inviting me to give my simple, humble words to share with you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, ma'am. You have given to us a valuable your time. You have explained many formulas for the treating ENT and eye disorders, including the diagnosis area. You have covered all the ENT factors for the which is useful for the students and the practitioners and for us also. Thank you very much, ma'am. Now, the second session of the webinar. For this session, we have the chairperson, our beloved and all the students of the government colleges from the Maharashtra, the Vaidya, Honorable Vaidya Nisar Ali Khan sir. He's associate professor at Government Ayurvedic College, Nanded, Maharashtra. He is working since near about 25 years as a lecturer and then the associate professor. He also gives the lecture on the research methodology and statistics. He is most beloved for the students as UG and the PG student I request to ma'am, we have to continue session or
yeah, just for 5 minutes, Dr. Khan sir will give his speech about the first session, also some tips for the general practice.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Please, Khan sir, Honorable Khan sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yeah. Am I audible? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for giving me opportunity. Just let me start my video. Thanks for Dhate sir, Yerme madam, and asking to say something about after Dhiman sir and Shanta Kumari madam. It is a very tough task for me. And thank you Dhate sir for saying me the beloved teacher. You are my friend. That's why you may be loving me. So Professor Dhiman sir was in a hurry. Actually, he is examination there. That's why he couldn't give much of the his thoughts and his time. But what he has given is really valuable. And such things, what he has mentioned is important point is that in internship, we have to take these treatments, get it done from the interns so that it will give them confidence. And if they see that with this drop, it is with this application, this disease is being cured, that will give them confidence and they will continue it for the for another for their life. One or two small tips. Okay, speaking after Dhiman sir is not that much fair, but for the sake of knowledge of our students, I would like to add one to two or three some things. Just what we have seen in the COVID cases, in the COVID epidemic, what we in the COVID pandemic actually, what we have seen, the no antiviral drugs were effective. What they were giving, just the steroids and thrombolytics and so-called remdesivir, etc., antiviral, but they were not that much effective what the expectations were from the drugs. But on the contrary, the pupils, what they continued the various kadas of dalchini and kalimiren, sunti kada, etc. It gave them very much. And what we advise to our patients in the form of patya, just don't take the curd, don't take the bit sour drinks, or don't take the ice creams, or don't take this one, don't take cold water bath, etc. Avoid ACs and avoid direct fan breeze, etc. All these things, these are mentioned in our text as a patya. What we give as a patya, these actually, these are the remedy for the many viral conditions, simply viral rhinitis, what Dhiman sir has also explained. One two tips I would like to add. Just one is the simple medicine, that is the Yashti Madhu, Jyeshta Madha. Simply any type of gingivitis or periodontitis, even in early cases, early stages of the upilis, if you apply Jyeshta Madha to the locally on the lesion, it will surely subside the lesion inflammatory process. In the marginal gingivitis, it gives good results. Even in tonsillitis, pharyngitis, it gives good results. Even in hoarseness of the voice or the laryngitis, we can add with the sitopaladi and we can give to the patients. And one thing is pratimarshanase. Actually, pratimarshanase is advised to put 2 drops in each nostril. Sushruta has recommended for almost, if Dhiman sir is listening, hello, good afternoon, Dhiman sir. Dhiman sir, good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Hello. Is present in the sir.
He is present, but he is busy in conversation with someone other. So I have modified the pratimarshanasya Pratimashna say, I would like just to put one drop in each nostril with the help of finger. Not only it will smoothen the vestibule of the nose to avoid in case of vestibulitis or the cracking, to avoid the cracking of the vestibule, and even little area bleeding can be prevented for the next time. It will be surely prevented. It will be surely prevented, and not more than. And it is not only effective at the anterior part of the nasal cavity, but it prevents much. It resolves many of the chronic sinusitis, chronic pharyngitis, chronic tonsillitis. It gives help, much help to resolve in these conditions. And more to that, I will say that this NASA will not only affect locally, but it will surely be helpful for further neurological conditions, to prevent further neurological conditions also. So I think these one or two additions I would like to add only. And speaking with Shanta Kumari madam and Dhiman sir is a great honor to me. I would like to thank organizers, and please continue your second session.
Thank you very much, sir, for being an urgent call. You are presented on my one call. Thanks again. You have discussed as a current issues according to this COVID, and you have added some formulas for gingivitis, periodontitis, tonsillitis, and a modified Pratimashna. Definitely, this will be helpful for us. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much. Now, ma'am, can we start the second session? Hear me, madam. Hear me, madam. Now, ma'am is not hearing. Now we can start the second session of this webinar. For this second session, we have an eminent speaker, Honorable Vaidya Kunjal Bhatt ma'am. She is associate professor at GS Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, Nadiad, Gujarat. The topic of this session is therapeutic procedures in Shalakya Tantra. I request to Honorable Vaidya Kunjal Bhatt ma'am to deliver the lecture. Gunjal ma'am.
Eight minutes. Yes, ma'am, unmute kiji, please. You can unmute now.
Yes, now I was trying, but you have not allowed me, so I was not able to unmute.
No, already you have, you are okay. Co-host, thank but you. I think you lost that. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, madam. Respected Shanta Kumari madam, Nisar Ali Khan sir, very good afternoon. Shilpa madam, Rajendra sir, very good afternoon to all of you and all the participants who are listening this webinar. Let me share my screen. Okay. Is it visible full screen mode or?
Yes, this is PC mode, ma'am, not a full screen. Okay. You have to... Yes, we can see.
Is it okay now? Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So for today's presentation, my topic is therapeutic procedures in orodontal diseases specifically, not in whole Shalakya Tantra, but because if we're going to cover the whole Shalakya Tantra therapeutic procedures, it will take a lot more time. So today we'll be limiting up our session up to orodontal diseases only. So what are the orodontal diseases in Ayurveda? What is the status of orodontal diseases in Ayurveda? So first of all, it is mentioned as a Mukha Roga in Nidanasana. The symptoms and clinical pictures are mentioned in Nidanasana, and the Chikitsa is mentioned in the 22nd chapter. Acharya has given 7 ayatananda has mentioned totally 65 or Bhagavat has mentioned 75 diseases. So we cannot say that orodentistry was not developed in that era, because total 65 or 75 diseases are mentioned in our classics. Total Netra Rog Sankhya is also 76 and Acharya has mentioned 75, 65 Mukh Rogs. So we cannot say that orodentistry was not developed in that era. But yes, in between the this period, the orodentistry of Ayurveda was not that much popularized, and that's why this is less popularized branch and less explored branch of Shalakya Tantra. Speaking of Nidana of Mukh Roga, this is very famous shloka, and if we see the Nidana, most of the Nidana are Ushna in nature or Snigdha in nature or Guru in nature. So it causes vitiation and prakop of kapha and rakta dosha, and it creates the Mukha Roga of different ayatana. Means the prominent dosha is kapha in association with rakta, and if it is getting lodged into the dantamool, it will cause dantamoolagat rog. If it is getting lodged in jiva, it will cause jivagat roga. So likewise of all ayatana. And if we see the third line, in the third and fourth line, Acharya has mentioned that the routine procedure, like in Dinacharya, we follow Danta Dhavana, Dhumapana, Gandusha. And if we are not following that properly, it will definitely lead to some kind of Mukha Roga. So here, the oral hygiene maintenance is given equal importance in the case of Nidana. Aharaj Nidana are there, as well as Viharaj Nidana, like Danta Dhavan, Dhumapana, or Sevan, Gandush, or Sevan. And even periodical Siraved is given very much importance, because the dosha travels through Rakta, and if Rakta is in a proper state, the disease will not take place. So Nidana is to be taken in consideration, because while we are focusing on the treatment, if you are giving everything, means internal medicine, local therapeutic procedures, but if you are not withdrawing the Nidana from the patient, you are not going to get a sufficient result or satisfactory result. So whenever you are taking history, this Nidana are to be kept in the mind, and detail oral hygiene history should be taken, and changes or modification are to be made if something is wrong. So again, if we see the modern medicine, the causes of orodental diseases are high sugar diet, improper oral hygiene, use of tobacco, alcohol consumption, sticky food consumption. All these are also labeled as causes in modern medicine also. And if we see the chikitsa part of Mukha Roga, surgical management is mentioned in some of the orodental diseases like Adhimansa, Vardhan, Krimi Danta, etc. And in some of the diseases, systemic measures are mentioned like Vamana Virechan. And in most of the diseases, local therapeutic procedures like Kavala, Gandusha, Pratisara, and Raktamoksha, Nasya, Dhumpan, these are mentioned. So if you analyze the treatment of Mukha Roga, you will see very few diseases in which systemic in medicine are administered. Otherwise, in most of the diseases, the local therapeutic procedures are sufficient. But again, we have to keep in mind that with these local therapeutic procedures, you have to improve the oral hygiene of the patient. And as Dhiman sir told earlier, that if patient is having any GI problem like Amla Pitta or Ajirna, you have to take that also in consideration. Then you administer the systemic medicine. Otherwise, the local medicine will be sufficient after improving the oral hygiene. So if we see Mukha Roga Samanya Chikitsa, Bhagavat Acharya has clear cut mentioned that you have to focus on kapha and rakta while you are doing the chikitsa of Mukha Roga. And keeping this in mind, see what anubandha is there, if whether vata dosha is involved or pitta dosha is involved, and then you follow the treatment. But you have to keep kapha dosha and rakta dosha in mind, because mukha is sthana of kapha dosha, so it would be there in any disease. So you have to keep that in mind to cure a kapha and a rakta. So our first therapeutic procedure is Kaval and Gandush. It is having preventive and therapeutic use both. If you see Charak Sutra Sand 5, in which in Dinacharya chapter, it is mentioned that Kaval and Gandusha should be followed daily. If a person is healthy, he should go for the Tela Gandusha or simple Sukhoshna Gandusha. And if person is having any disease, then particular examples are mentioned. Definition is known to everyone. Types, if we see, four types are mentioned. According to the action, the medicine delivers at the certain place and on certain dosha, like snehanna for vata dosha, prasadan for pitta dosha, shodhan for kapha dosha, and ropana for vrana. And in addition to this, Acharya Vakpat has mentioned some more liquids and drugs. Means if you wanted to give Kaval and Gandusha with liquid medium, Acharya Vakpat has mentioned some specific liquids also, like Snehan can be given with Sneha, Mansarasa, Kshir, etc. Prasadan type of Gandusha can be given with Kshir, Ikshurasha, Grita. Shodhan type of Kaval Gandusha can be given with Shukta Madhya Mutra, and Ropan can be given with the Ropaniya Dravya with Pitta Shamak liquids. So these are some common guidelines. If you are not reaching up to any conclusion to diagnose any disease, you just follow this guideline. According to dosha, you can give the Kaval and Gandusha. Further to this shloka, Acharya Vakpat has mentioned that Gandusha Dharane Nityam Taila Mansarasvatva. Means if a healthy person wants to perform Gandusha every day, he should go for Taila Gandusha. It can be anything, Tail, Irimedari Tail, or Divail, means Aranda Tail. Or in specific condition like Danta Harsha, Danta Chal, which are with predominant condition. So Sukhoshanam Athava Sheeta Tilkalka Udakam Hitam. Means Tilkalka Udakam can be given as a Sukhoshana or Sheet, because in case of Danta Harsha, patient might not be able to tolerate hot or cold. So here option has been given. Otherwise in Vatik condition, you should keep the liquid a little bit lukewarm, so it will give the more result. So same for Pittaj and Kaphaj condition, Acharya has given some examples. So these are the common guidelines. Which type of action do you want? According to that, you can give the prescription. Now coming to procedure, Nivate Satape Sukhopavishta Tanmanna. So patient should be seated in a Nivata and with proper ventilation, with proper light. But here, what I want to highlight is Vara Madhya Avaram Pramad Vaktra Ardha Tribhaga Chaturbhaga Purani. So, the quantity of the liquid should be capacity half, one third, or one fourth capacity of the full mouth liquid. And that liquid should be held or rooted in the mouth according to the diseased condition. If you are going to perform the Kaval or Gandusha with Kalka, it should be up to Kola Pramana. And whenever Kaval or Gandusha is being performed, the head of the patient should be little elevated. So you should keep the head little bit elevated. Now I would like to make one suggestion here, that if you want your medicine to act on gums and teeth, the head should not be elevated this much. But if you want your medicine to act upon tonsil, pharynx, or larynx, then this much head elevation should be given. Otherwise, you modify the head posture according to your disease condition and the action you want on which place. So, and this procedure according to the matra can be given according to the severity of the disease and according to the comfort level of the patient, because each and everyone will not be comfortable with a half capacity of the liquid. And this should be repeated up to 3, 5, or 7 times till you get the samyak yoga lakshana. See, many times we prescribe Kaval and Gandusha, but we don't get the desired result. So what can be the cause? The first cause can be we are not doing fomentation or mardana after giving Kaval. Yes, in Purva Karma, definitely we are performing Snehan and Svedan. But in after Paschat Karma, again Svedan and Mardan is mentioned. So this step we are not following, and which is limiting our result. And another thing, that it can be repeated up to 3, 5, or 7 times till you get this Samyak Yoga Lakshana. Because when you take liquid in the mouth, and when you start holding, it is not like that now you are getting bored and now you are tired, so you just spit it out. You have to tell the patient to retain the liquid, and you have to observe that, because when I tried, I could hold up the liquid till 20 minutes. So 3, 5, or 7 times you can advise the patient, and you have to observe that. Even Sushrut has mentioned that you have to give again. If in one time you are not getting the samyak yogdarshan, you have to give it again and again till the vyadhi apachay is found. So here are the assessment: samyak yog, hin yog, ati yog lakshana. So whenever you are prescribing any procedure, make sure to take follow up on the next day, because what happens, this type of procedure, orodontal procedure, we advise to take patient at home and we don't take follow up. Each and every procedure should be assessed on the next day, and these checklist should be made, and you have to see with what kind of lakshana you are finding on the next day. So this will help you in improving your procedure and improving your result. So if anything is going wrong in the procedure, anything going wrong in the drug, if patient is not obeying you, means after a procedures there are some instruction which patient is not following, then again the result will not be up to the mark. So you have to take assessment in each and every procedure, either minor or major. Clinically, if we see the indication of Kaval and Gandusha, first of all, it is mentioned in Dantaharsha, Dantavest, Paridhar, Shitat, Sushir. So in Dantaharsha, it is mentioned as first line of treatment. Means in Dantaharsha, you can give, first of all, you should give the Gandusha because it is pure vyatic disorder. In Dantavest, Shitat, Sushir, Paridhar, it is mentioned after a Rakta Moksha. So in this type of disease where Rakta Dusti is more, first you have to go for a Rakta Moksha, and then you go for Kaval Gandusha. If you are not going for Rakta Moksha, only prescribing Kaval and Gandusha, your result will be not up to the mark or not satisfactory. And again, in Kafaj, Medha, Jost, Rog, Adhimans, Upakush, Jiva, Kantak, Mukh, Paak. So here you have to follow the chronological order, that after which procedure Kaval and Gandusha is prescribed, and whether Kaval is prescribed or Gandusha is prescribed. Sometimes the word is used Kaval Graha. So again, Kaval Graha can be taken as Gandusha, not as a Kaval procedure or rotation of the liquid in the mouth. Clinically, what can be the indications for Kaval and Gandusha? So again, attrition, abrasion as Dantaharsha, mobile teeth, OSMF, oral submucous fibrosis. This is a very good scope for Ayurvedic practitioners. You can give a good result in this with simple measures like Kaval and Gandusha. Here we can see that the mouth opening is only 2 fingers, so up to 2, 2.5 finger opening you can give good result. But if the mouth opening is less than 1 finger or 1 finger, the result will be difficult. In dental caries, bleeding gums, stomatitis, of course in OSMF you can give Gandusha with Kshirbala tail, Bala tail, Tildel, Arandatail, anything, whichever available with you. In bleeding gums, stomatitis, the extended use of Kaval and Gandusha can be taken as eustachian tube dysfunction, pharyngitis, and laryngitis. So eustachian tube dysfunction, it gives very good result, Kaval and Gandusha, even in cases of ASOM. Kaval and Gandusha can give good result, and not only Kaval and Gandusha, associated with other treatment, but it can be helpful in relieving the eustachian tube blockage, and it will help in the drainage of the middle ear secretions. So this is again can be taken as extended use of Kaval and Gandusha other than the oral cavity diseases. The next one is therapeutic procedure is Dhumapan. So it is preventive, promotive, and therapeutic use can be achieved with Dhumapan. If we see its phalashruti, it is helpful in prashamaya, bruhanaya, and prasadanaya. So three of the actions can be achieved from a dhumapan. Even in asya, vairasya, praseka, galaroga, dantashula, dorbalya, aruchi, hanumanya, graha, krumi, etc. are the indication. Dhumapan is a less practiced procedure, but it is very much effective. Especially it is less practiced in orodentistry, but it should be practiced more because it gives excellent result. three types are there: snehik, prayogik, vairochanik. And if we see the kala, eight kala are mentioned for dhumpan, in which prayogik and vairochanik are specifically mentioned after dant dhavan and divaswapna, which can be utilized for orodental diseases in Ayurveda. So you can advise your patient to take dhumpan after these two specific dant dhavan and divaswapna kala. So it will help. It will be helpful in improving the orodental strength of the patient. Procedure, this we are not going into detail, but yes, if you are not having traditionally or classically made the dhuma yantra, then you can do some modification. Here we have a dhuma yantra made of clay, at which one end we have placed the varti, and from the second end patient is taking dhumpan. Because it is made up of clay, our nursing staff is very much careless, so they broke on every third or fourth day. Then we decided to have it with the steel. So this is the steel. And another thing, here you can place dhumvarti, but if you are not having the dhumvarti prepared, but you are having raw powder of the drugs, then you can utilize utilize those powders with this method. You just put powders, neem patra, sarsap beej, and gugar and ghee, and you just wait for the fumes to come out, and patient can take dhumapan. So again, it gives very good result. Here, what we have to keep in mind, that nasa dhumapan is more effective in the diseases of nose and pharynx. But when we want our effect in the oral area, the inhalation and exhalation should be from the mouth only. Mukhe natu mukhe ev. So this type of modification we make, and in our patients, here the patient is taking dhuma with mouth only. Here one picture of dhuma netra I got from the Ashtanga Hridaya, in which actually the dhuma netra should be three parva or three kosha like, because the fumes, if you are getting direct from the varti, it will come with some type of particle and it will be very strong. Sometimes it becomes very difficult. If it is a shirovirachan type of dhuma varti, it becomes very difficult for patient to take 9 times. So if the fumes are coming from the distance, then it becomes little bit milder, the sedimentation will be settled down, and only fumes will get into your nose. So ideally this type of dhuma netra should be prepared, and even with sharab you can prepare. So I consider this as a scope of research or scope of marketing or scope of business in field of Ayurveda, where lack of classically made instrument is there, and because of the lacking of proper instrumentation, we are avoiding some procedures. Like if you are not having dhuma netra, you will not go for dhumpan. You are not preparing dhumvarti, then you will not go for dhumpan. So this is a little bit question, and it is limiting our practice, so it should not be there. So indications of dhumpan: aruchi, praseka, dantashula, pharyngitis, tonsillitis, krimidanta, dantaharsha, ostaroga. In clinically, we can give in dantashula, in krimidant, if patient is coming to us with severe pain, dhupan or dhumapan will give excellent result. Otherwise, in oral cavity diseases, we just prescribe the drugs which patient can take at home. But remember, in most of the cases, patient is getting cured with these OPD simple medicines only, as Nisar sir said, that give Yasti Madhu. So Yasti Madhu is like God to us for oral cavity diseases. If you are getting nothing, prescribe Yasti Madhu. It will definitely give result. But when you are not getting satisfactory result, or if you are not able to cure the disease, you have to think of other therapeutic procedures, and you have to think once again for your treatment plan if you are not getting a complete result. There are 19 mukha roga which are said asadhya. So in those diseases, you need not to make any claims to cure disease, those asadhya diseases which are clear cut mentioned as asadhya diseases. But yes, in sadhya diseases, we surely can have good results. The next upakram is Vranadhupan. It is mentioned as Vranadhupan, but it gives excellent result in a kind in conditions of pain and discharge. So what happens many time, CA patients which are having malignancy, recurrence, and even after taking radio and chemo, but still they are having the lesion. Sometimes it is oozing, sometimes it is severe painful, because generally the lesions of oral cavity and ulcerative lesions are severe painful. Patient is not able to bear that pain. So in that type of ulcers which are having pain and oozing, Vranadhupan will give excellent result, because it is clearly indicated that Vatatmakan Ugra Rujan Sa Sravan Api Chavranan. Even I have seen a patient at our level, means in specific Shalakya, because generally we don't admit those patients which are having the recurrence or which are having the last stage of cancer. We just advise Dhupan at home. We advise that take the cow dung and take the Google from the market and put some ghee, and then you take the Dhuma for twice a day. So we don't admit those patient in the last stage. We just advise them to take Dhupan at home. But one patient was admitted in our hospital and severe pus discharge was resolved within a week with two times of Dhupan. So Dhupan again gives excellent result. Krimidanta in classic, it is mentioned that Kantakari Bij Dhuma is very much giving very much promising result in pain of Krimidanta. Next therapeutic procedure is Rakta Moksan. So as we started our presentation, that Kapha and Rakta are the main dosh and dushya. So Rakta Mokshan will definitely give good result in case of Shitada, Danta Pukkuta, Danta Waste, etc. In many diseases, Rakta Mokshan is mentioned, which is followed by other therapeutic procedures like Lepan, Kavala, Gandusha, Pramarjan, then Dhavan. So even Shirovirechan. So many procedures are mentioned, but starts with the Rakta Mokshan. So where the bleeding type of disorder is there or acute swelling is there, you can go for the Rakta Mokshan. So with Rakta Mokshan can be done with the help of Ghost Piece, Chaloka Vacharan and Siravid. Siravid we don't prefer, but Ghost Piece and Chaloka Vacharan can be done. So here in this case, like the gum recession is there, gum is bleeding, gum is having pus discharge. So you just rub the gums with the ghost paste. First you let the vitiated blood drain and then you give the treatment. So this will give excellent result. And what other practice we follow, which I have learned from my senior, that she advised the patient to massage the gums. In the lower gums, you just massage the gums in upper direction, and in upper gums, you massage the gums in the lower direction, and you just squeeze it, and you just squeeze the blood and the debris and pus, and then you start the Munjan or Pratisaran or Kaval Gandush. So, in a smaller amount, daily patient will have some type of Rakta Mokshan, so it will give a more result. And again, if patient comes to you with the complaint of bleeding, don't go for any Stambhana Dravya. Like if you prescribe Dashan Sanskar and Spatika, it will give good result. On the next follow-up, patient will say, yes, that bleeding is stopped. But initially, first for 2-3 days or few days, you go for Rakta Mokshan and then you give other treatment. So it will take your treatment to the next level. Pratisaran. Kalka, Rasakriya, Shodram, Churnam, Cheti, Chaturvidam. Pratisaran is mentioned of four types. Anguli, Agra, Pranitam, Tu, Yathasvam, Mukharoginam. In each Mukharog, you can go for the Pratisaran. And if you see the treatment, Pratisaran is mentioned in most of the diseases. The four types are mentioned like Kalka, Rasakriya, Kshodra, Churna. Kshodra means coarse powder. So if the powder is coarse, the scraping effect will be achieved. So if you want If you see some hypertrophied area or if you want to some type of lekhan karma, you should prescribe shaudra. Otherwise, churna or rasakriya will be sufficient. And in commentary, it is mentioned that the matra of pratisaran should be up to kolasthi, and that kolasthi praman matra should be repeatedly applied over the affected site for 5-7 types according to the disease, heena, madhya or uttam. So it is fixed that matra should be kolasthi praman and it should be repeatedly done. And again, if the patient is having severe pain, severe burning, you can repeatedly ask the patient to do pratisaran, like 3 or 4 times in a day. In simple aphthous ulcer, we give yasti madhu with grit and honey 3 to 4 times, or after eating, or if the patient is not able to eat before meal, you also can suggest this pratisaran. So 3 to 4 times patient can use this pratisaran. Same Ashtanga Sangraha has mentioned that pratisaranam tu trividam. And one more thing which I would like to highlight it, that whatever drugs mentioned in the Gandush, even Shadandar has mentioned this, that whatever drugs are mentioned in Gandush can be used as pratisaran. So there are so many options. In few diseases, the yoga is mentioned. So you go for that yoga, and if not available, some kind of Gandush dravya are with you, you can use those also. In Osht Prakop, Danta Puputak, Danta Sharkara, Jeeva Rog, etc., the Pratisaran is mentioned. Like in Danta Sharkara, Pratisaran is mentioned after the Aharan Karma. So you must remember the chronological order of that particular procedure and the indication. And clinically, we are using Pratisaran in OSMF, ulcers, gingivitis, tonsillitis, etc., which gives good result. Like in tonsillitis, simple Haridra. In gingivitis, means with honey, Haridra with honey. In gingivitis, yasti madhu with honey. Ulcer also, we can prescribe yasti madhu. OSMF, we use Haridra, Sandhav, Haridra, Gairik, and Sandhav. So this type of combinations can be used. And as Dhiman sir mentioned, if ulcer and gingivitis and is there because of the disturbed GI tract, we must take the history of that and we must add some treatment for that also. And if tonsillitis is of allergic origin, we must try to improve overall immunity of the patient. Not only we have to focus on the local things. Okay. Now, indication of labor. So in pratisaran, we have to rub the paste over the space. And for a lep, we just have to apply once. So this is the difference between these two. And if you refer the Samhita, you will find that somewhere pratisaran is mentioned and somewhere only lep is mentioned. So where lep is mentioned, like in Sita and Saushir, in which the gums are already swollen, already bleeding, you need not to go for the pratisaran. Go for the raktamokshan and just apply the paste of the medicine. Don't go for the rubbing of that paste, and in krimidant also. The next one is nasya. So this is the less popularized or less practiced therapeutic procedure for orodontal diseases. But it is, if you are not happy with the result with these previous local procedures, you add this procedure as well. And you'll get excellent result. Like in Shita, the Danta Puputak, Danta Waste, Danta Harsha, Jeeva Rog. Once what happened, a patient was coming to our OPD for hair fall, for treatment of hair fall. And here we are using Yasti Madhu Tel for Marshanasa. So after so many sittings, she was having severe hair fall. So after 5 or 6 sittings of Nasya, she told me that previously I was having bleeding gums, and after this Nasya, my bleeding gum stopped. So it was not there in her complaint anywhere in the case paper, but she reported that after Nasya, my bleeding gums are cured. So at that time, I realized that how many of us will prescribe Shaman Nasya in case of Shita, or how many of us will prescribe Vaman Virechan or Shiro Virechan in case of Upkush. If patient is coming to us for pyorrhea, we'll just prescribe simple medicine. No one will advise Vaman Virechan or Shiro Virechan. So here we have to improve our practice, that you clarify the patient that I am giving this to you for the first step, but if we are not happy with the result, the next step will be this. Means if your bleeding gums are not stopped with simple pratisaran or simple lep, simple cover kandush, you will have to come to our place for daily till you get cured. So this will help to improve our means the practitioner as that he or she is very much clear in the mind that what next you are going to plan for the patient. So this thing you have to include your practice to give a good impression over patient that no, they are planning treatment or they are giving treatment step by step. And if he or she will be ready for the next step, yeah, that if I'm not getting cured, I'll have to get admit and I have to go through this panchakarma procedure and then I'll get result. Because sometimes if the disease is too much, severity is too much, you have to go for panchakarma. So what are the benefit of these local therapeutic procedures? It has direct contact with the target tissue. So it will definitely give fast result. Contact time is manageable, means if in terms of frequency, means if severity is more, you can ask the patient to have kaval gandush for 3-4 times. Okay, variety of formulations, means kalka, rasakriya, churna, then kwatha, kalka, this variety of formulations we have. Temperature can be controlled, like if vataj is there and you are giving lukewarm oil or your lukewarm water, it will definitely give good result. And if a vrana is there, ulcer is there, temperature of that particular medicine will be cold and it will definitely give result. So temperature is in your hand. Area of action, means kaval gandush can be helpful up to eustachian tube dysfunction, even laryngitis. So area of action is very wide. Even Astang has mentioned that kaval and gandush can be helpful in diseases of eye also. So somewhere in the treatment of abhishan, the kaval gandush is mentioned. So area of action is very much larger, and variety of action, like you can have swedan, you can have shodan, prashaman, even prasadan karma. So day to day basis we need prasadan karma. So variety of action are also available. It has some limitation, although we have seen that so many procedures and we can get good results, but yes, definitely they are not useful in Shastra Sadhya Roga. Where clear cut surgery is indicated, you don't go for the conservative cure, or you aware the patient that this is not going to give complete relief. It gives only symptomatic relief in Asadhya Roga up to some extent, as I said, in malignancy. Sometimes a single procedure is sufficient, and sometimes you have to go for multiple procedures at the same time. Like raktamokshan should be followed by lepa karma, or raktamokshan or chedan in adhimansa should be followed by pratisara. So sometimes you keep in mind the sequence or the chronological order in which the samhita has said. So you just follow that order, and then it will give the good result. Responsibility of vaidya, hetulinga prashamana, and roganam apunarbhava. So once you are curing the disease is not sufficient, but you make sure that that disease is not going to relapse, and for that you have to improve the habits of oral hygiene of the patient, because it plays the major role. Acharya has given equal importance to aharaj nidan to viharaj nidan. Even I say that kala shodan, means seasonal panchakarma, should be encouraged in public. Now after COVID, more awareness is created in public regarding Ayurveda, so we should take the advantage of this. Dhumapan, again I said that limitation of dhumavarti and limitation of dhumanetra, this are the limiting the scope of this wonderful procedure, which gives excellent result. It has yes, it gives excellent result in case of allergic rhinitis or vasomotor rhinitis or pharyngitis. It is less used in orodentistry, but yes, it should be popularized more. And gandush should be practiced on daily basis. If tail gandush is not possible, simple sukhoshna sukoshna daka kaval gandusha should be followed even after meal or diva swapna. If you take gandusha of sukoshna daka, then you'll feel a lightness in your mouth. So definitely it will give good result. So take home message would be that you create public awareness. As an Ayurvedic physician, it becomes your duty to create public awareness regarding oral hygiene. The concepts which are mentioned in Ayurveda, as I said in the starting of the lecture, that Acharya has mentioned 65 or 75 diseases. So it was not like diseases were not there in that era. But they were using datun for their oral hygiene. And nowadays we are using sweet toothpaste. So definitely the effect of rasa will not be achieved. So this concept should be popularized into public. And the measures mentioned in Dinacharya should be popularized. Start applying these therapeutic procedures at your OPD because it needs minimal setup. Even if kaval and gandusha or pratisaran, you can advise those procedures at OPD basis only. Once you explain the whole procedure, you take the follow-up on second day and you keep in touch with your patient with phone or any else medium, message or phone. But you take follow-up and you once you explain, there will not be as such an emergency in these type of procedure as we found in Vaman or Virechan. So these needs minimal setup can be practiced on OPD basis and these are affordable. So it becomes our duty to create public awareness and to start applying these procedure at our setup. So I would like to thank the organizers and for allowing me to present my views over therapeutic procedures in orodontal diseases. And I would like to thank once again Shanta Kumari Madam, Nisar Ali Khan Sir, Dr. Shilpa Madam and Dr. Rajendra Sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for covering as a orodontal disease as area of Shalakya Tantra, including the Samanya Chikitsa of orodontal cavities. You have also discussed the position while doing the kaval gandush, explained the time to holding, etc. You give an ideas about the Dhumi Yantra also, which is helpful to us. I explained as a gum massage and many formulas to treat the orodontal disease. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now, I request to Honorable Vaidya P.K. Shanta Kumari ma'am to give concluding remark on this session. Shanta Kumari ma'am, please.
Okay. Thank you all for inviting me for this session. And dear Kunjal Bhatt, you have done a very nice work and very practically useful one. And we like the, it is very nice for and useful for youngsters and also for beginners. Anyway, keep it up. That is my first advice.
Thank you.
And then the thing is that the theory is very, very good in our system. Ayurveda has given a very good theory. There is no lack of it. Only problem is practical implementation. It is remaining in the same way even now. That is the fact. Everybody is speaking of theories and how to do practically. That should be solved. You have mentioned one thing to modify the Dhuma Yantra like that. That is a very good thing. We can't go to the Isha and other things for making Dhuma Yantra or like, it is not possible. But we can do something extra. We have to go innovative ways. That is what is necessary nowadays. We have to give the need of that to the students. Okay, because like that we can modify so many instruments. I have made this Nasya chair. It is a modified form of this dental chair. Because we can raise it to the this vertical position and to the horizontal position by simple hydraulic pressure And we can't ask the patient to stand up and go to the wash basin for spitting out like that. They can do it in the lying position itself, and we can change the position like that. Like that, so many modifications are necessary in each and every field of our procedures. Even for Shirodhara table, we can't ask them to climb because the patients may be sometimes unable to walk. So we can arrange the table in such a way with the hydraulic pressure, we can raise it up and down and keep it like that. This is a simple example you have done in the Dhumayantra, like the Nasya position, Nasya Yantra, Nasya chair. And for this Kabla spitting, like that, in each and every step we have to make, we have to take the advantage of the latest technologies. That is my advice, especially in the field of Shailakya. For applying the Sega for the eye, we can't use that type of Pijuvarti in anything. It is not, we can't make it what I will say, sterilize, or to put it everything like that. So we have to use something which can be sterilized daily. In that way, you have to think of, when we are giving this spark to the students, they will take, they will start to think of it and make new instruments and devices to do the practice in their own clinic. I mean, practical implementation of the theory. We can't, for that we have to take the advantage of all the technologies, physics, chemistry, and electronics like that. And every new practitioner has to think of it, especially we can start in the colleges. Then this rectamotion, especially Jalavaga Vajrana, we have mentioned, that is highly fruitful. Where all the other treatments fail, we can go for Jalavaga Vajrana. Recently, the latest case, yesterday I has discharged a patient from my hospital. He came to me, funny thing, he came to me in search of treatment for keratoconus. I had online consultation with him, and he is from Punjab actually. And by online consultation, he had reports that there is a keratoconus and the head device is C3R. And he was not interested in that, vision is coming down. That was the diagnosis. And he came here for that only. When he came here and was admitted, then while examining, I could understand that he was suffering from BKC, vernal keratoconjunctivitis, and the lids were highly inflamed. And it was because of this, the corneal edema and other fluid accumulation came. And without touching this inflammation, we can't do anything in the cornea. So I was treating him with the Jalavaga Vajrana alone for 3-4 times. Then became the cornea also became clear because of the fluid was drained out and it became clear. And keratoconus also was solved. Like that, so many examples are there. And there was a patient, the patient means he's a professor in the Ayurveda college itself. Highly chronic gingivitis. And he was doing so many medicines, internal and external and allopurinol like that. And finally, we jointly decided to do Jalavaga Vajrana on the gums. And after that, only it got subsided. So we can, in the nasal polyp also, we have done it with high risk, whether it will be moving to the nasal cavity, but that also became a success. So Jalavaga Vajrana is a highly successful treatment. Nasyam we cannot need not say. It is the best treatment. And we have to consider this. I have done Nasyam with the Rekta in a Kabaja Shirishula, Krimija Shirishula, and was taking blood from his own hand. And I used for nasya, and I had only read from the book that krimi will come out, but it happened. It was white, soft, small krimis. It came out through the when she was spitting out, and not through the kaba from the mouth. It is coming out through the nostril itself. That means which is written in our book. It is a truth everybody knows, but we have to implement it practically. it was for the first time I was doing Nasim with the Rekha. Don't know which Rekha, whether from the outside or from his own, it was not written that. So I was taking his own, that patient's own rectum finally, but it was a successful thing. He was relieved from the this one. Like that, these things, we have to give examples and training also in these procedures to the students. Since you are in college, I am saying all these things. And I also was a teacher for 40 years in different Hyderabad colleges. So I can say how to train the students, show them practically. No other means, no need of any theory. We can show them. But since I have done this Rekha Nasya, my students have done it later. I came to know. Like that, the only thing is we have to modify the technologies and show the students practically. Live demonstration only is the only solution to solve the existing problem. Because oral diseases are handled by few doctors only in Ayurveda, I know. But generally, these patients go to general practitioners also, not to the Salaki specialists. So such as some arrangement should be there for Dhumapana, for Nasya, for Kabla, for Gandosha, like that. And also if there are some, many successful, Mugha Labanam also should be mentioned there. In so many oral diseases, this Mugha Labanam is very powerful, that can be used. Also this Shiro Labanam, Shiro Udvartanam, many people are not doing it. I am doing it in a great way that can be used in many conditions. Just like a body Udvartanam, we can start it with the Shiras also we can do Udvartanam. But this Varanadi Ganam or the even Rasanadi Churnam, Tribula Churnam, and like that we can select the medicine that because Udvartana Kavaharam Medasa Pravilayanam. This face and all the oral diseases are mostly of Kapha dominance. And in such a conditions, we can start this, we can implement this Shiro Udvartanam also. Shiro Labanam, everybody knows that can be done with the dominant condition. That is, but these procedures also we can practically implement in different types of orodontal disease. That is what I want to mention. Many types of gingivitis, etc. The Shiro Udvartanam seems to be very highly effective. So anyway, you have done a very good work. You can add something else like this, Pradisaranam and this different types of Shiro Labana, Shiro Udvartana and the Mugha Labha, that also, and try to invest some more equipments. I have given an example for Nasya, like that. For Dhumapana, I had done one thing, just like only a hot plate, and we can put on that and have a steel or something with a washer, a funnel like. We can attach a tube, rubber tube on that, and we can put it in the nasal cavity of the patient. He can use it in a comfortable way. It is movable. Like that, so many things we can make. Without much expense. Even though it is expensive, it will be an asset for a practitioner. Never mind. But if you're starting it in the college, it will be a great, great work by a teacher. So try for that. And it will be a plus point for your career also. You'll be successful, all the best. And give the same thing to your students also. Anyway, thank you for giving such a nice speech, and I thank all the organizers for giving me a chance to share some words. I have so too much to say on this topic, especially if it is an eye disease. But time is limiting, so I am stopping here. Thank you all once again.
Thank you for your inputs, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am. I'm a little bit disappointed in the morning, as you said that you are busy in some work, but it's really good to hear you, to listen to you, ma'am. Thank you very much. That is all.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. We have a great opportunity to hear you. Your focus is on the practical orientation. We definitely remember this thing that which can give try to give to our students. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Now that is necessary.
Yes, of course. Yes, practical, of course. And thank.
Okay, yes, no, that is why we have to implement in the colleges first. Then only it will be spread.
Yes, of course. Okay. Thank you for sharing your practice experience also, which is useful for us. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now I request to Honorable Dr. Vaidya Nisar Ali Khan, sir, to give concluding remark on this session also. Khan, sir.
Yes. First of all, I would like to appreciate Dr. Kunjal Bhatt for her efforts, what she has taken for this lecture. She has covered a wide range and with a good depth and with really good practical approach she has added. And there is always a chance of improvement. Kunjal Madam, one thing I would like to add to you,
yes, sir,
that in case of gingivitis of various conditions or gingival hypertrophy, or in case of even marginal gingivitis, periodontitis and perioalveolaris, in all these things, and many of the mukhrogas, as we know, that these are of kapha raktaj in origin. So raktamokshan is advocated for the many of such conditions, and let it be the sarva doshaj or other doshaj, we can perform raktamokshan. So for raktamokshan, what you have told, that rubbing with the gauze, I think that will only cause a superficial trauma to the gingival epithelium. So avoiding this trauma, and in various conditions, the tissues are so fragile that that much rubbing can harm much to the tissues. So what we do, what is in our practice, and it is the aim of these sessions, that our practices should get interchanged. So what is in our practice, in our institution, what we do, we give some local anesthetic. Simply pick in one eye drops, one or two drop, or simply xylocaine jelly, you can rub, gently rub to the gums. Do multiple pricks, like 50 to 100 or 150 pricks. Just prick 1 to 2 millimeter into the gingiva. Multiple punctures at the gingiva, at the gum. You can go in the hard gingiva or the soft gingiva, whichever is affected, or interdental papillae or the dental margin. You can puncture them multiple times, and it will cause raktamokshana. Further, it will give all the benefits of raktamokshana. In addition to that every prick is going deep to 1 to 2 millimeter. That will get again contracted. That will get some fibrotic reaction to that, and those gingivitis will be solved, or the gingival hypertrophy may be solved in a good manner. Just you can have a try for this. It is a, I think it's my good suggestion to everybody, and it is our practice in our institution. And what Shanta Kumari Madam were telling, that orodental, actually it is Gujarat is far ahead to all of us in case of orodental practices. Dr. Haridra Dave is the pioneer. He is carrying all those Ayurved practitioners ahead in the orodental therapies. So it is one modification what we can do in the raktamokshana for the gingival conditions, and we are getting excellent results for that. Dr. Kunjal Madam and Shanta Kumari Madam have given very good practically useful tips for all the newcomers as well as the practitioners and teachers. Once again, I would like to thank Dr. Shilpa Erme Madam, Dr. Dhate, Dr. Rajendra Dhate, he is my student, and it is a really good privilege to be with Dr. Dhiman sir and Shanta Kumari Madam. and I would like to give my wishes to Kunjal Bhatt that she is going to be a very good future speaker in the field of Chalukya. So it is my today's remarks. Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your suggestion. We'll definitely include in our practice and we'll give you the next follow-up. So thank you.
Thank you, sir. I have to add one more thing here. Dr. Khan, sir, is specifically promoting to student to practice the for orodontal diseases in Chalukya Tantra. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Now there are question answer session. There are some questions from the delegates, which can give all the dignities. The first question is, what is the treatment for postnasal discharge during pratishaya or the sinusitis?
If postnasal discharge is there, you can give steam inhalation 3 to 4 times a day. And if the discharge is thick and avalambi ghana type, go for shirovirachan nasya. And as I mentioned, kaval and gandusha will give benefit. And steam inhalation, nasya, shirovirachan type, if the discharge is ghana, and kaval gandusha. These three procedures will help you, along with the mucolytic oral drugs.
Thank you, ma'am.
One more thing, Rajendra.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
A simple pratimashnasya will solve the much problem of the post nasal drip. It will somewhat liquefy the secretions. It pacifies the vata and it liquefies the secretion bit. So the nature of secretion changes and they will go by the ciliary action of the nasopharynx. One more thing, what she has already added, that the vasavaleha can be added, yashti madhu or tankana can be added to your drugs like sitopaladi, etc. If these drugs are added, tankana or yashti madhu, these are again mucolytics. Vasavalehi is one of the good and it contains bromhexin, as we all know. In this way, our students nowadays can understand. But vasa itself is a very good pitta shamak and very good mucolytic kasagna. So it vasavale will help surely.
Yes, of course, sir. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Another question is, what is the treatment for the itching over a hard palate in oral cavity on and off itching on the palate?
Itching in the palate can be associated with other allergic symptoms like allergic rhinitis or allergic pharyngitis. And as it is pure kapha symptom, shodhan type of kaval gandush, as we give in our OPD, tripla, trikatu, sandhav, svarjika, char. This combination can be given for kaval. And dhumapan will again give excellent result in kapha type of condition. And if allergy is associated, so overall improvement of autoimmune system should be given for oral medication. And this will definitely get resolved with these measures. And if any other suggestion from Shanta Kumari Madam and Nisar sir.
Itching of palate is nothing but the referred itching, referred pain from the nasal cavity. So in many times when you get any of the rhinitis, palate itching is one of the symptoms, palatal itching. So what she has already told, these procedures can be used to treat the rhinitis. Surely it will give relief from the itching. Just like it is, palatal itching is just like referred pain. The itching or the pain in the left back scapula or the ear itching when you get in the pharyngitis or the rhinitis. Itching of the ears. Itching of the palate is the same, secondary to rhinitis.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Shanta Kumari, ma'am. something?
Yes, usually it is same just like the, these speakers say, it is a referred symptom either from this rhinitis, but from sinusitis or from other local or neighbor structures. And simple this kabla and gandusha and other things will solve the problem. But if the root cause is there, just like a sinusitis or middle ear infection like that, it is persisting, this will come again. So we have to find out the root cause and clear it permanently. Then only the recurrence can be avoided. That is my suggestion. Once the palate and itching is already over, don't think it is permanently gone. Sometimes, just like doctor told, it may be a referred pain, referred itching from other sites. So, rule out that causative factor. That is very important in this condition. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question is a treatment for the Karna Nada. Anybody can share his experience or the treatment?
Okay.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yes, madam. Continue. I will tell later.
In Karna Nad, the basic principle for treatment is Sneha Svedan, Sneha Virechan, and then go for Karna Puran. So, first of all, the basic ear examination should be carried out to rule out any other cause. An audiogram is must before claiming any result to patient. And if it is due to sensory neural type of deafness, then you follow the line of treatment like Snehan Svedan, Sneha Virechan, and then Karna Puran along with Vathahar Basti, then it will give result. But when it comes to Karna Nad, the experience I have with the patient of Karna Nad, I have seen that if Karna Nad is chronic, as mentioned in our Samhitas, that if Badirya is also 1 year older, then it becomes Krichra Sadhya or Asadhya. So if tinnitus is of a chronic origin and if it is due to internal ear, not because of the middle ear or external ear pathology, then it becomes a little bit difficult to cure. But with 30 basti, as we do in our IPD, we admit the patient both for a thorough panchkarma like Snehan Svedan, Virechan, and then we give 30 basti. We are getting a good result. I'm not saying that we are curing Karna Nad, but we are getting good result in Karna Nad with this treatment protocol, basti and Karna Puran, and also oral medicines will help like ashwagandha. So in my knowledge and as we practice in our institute, I'll suggest this treatment.
Thank you, ma'am. Respected Khan sir, please.
Yes. First of all, we have to find out what is the cause of this tinnitus. For Karna Nada, if it is oral, then we can go for this Vata Shamak treatment. But if it is extra oral, it can be from the temporomandibular joint, it may be from the additional vessels, it may be systemic in origin. If it is systemic origin, if it is due to hypertension, it may be into the diabetes. So we have to find out the cause of that and treat accordingly. If you find no cause, only internal ear pathology and purely idiopathic or unknown of origin, unknown etiology is there, then we can do all the Vata Shamak. Karna Purana will surely add, and with the Karna Purana locally, we can perform the systemic Vata Shamak Upchar. More the Taila in the form of Shirobhayanga, Shiropichu, Shirodhara, etc., it will surely help. If it is Manyasthani, Snehan Svedan will surely help. So Vata Shamak Upchara with Vata Shamak Karna Purana, it can be given for the Karna Nad also.
Thank you so much, sir. Shanta Kumari, ma'am, please, your opinion for this.
Okay, Karna Nadam is a vata dominant condition generally, and a little associated with the kapha in many situation. In my experience, it may be of two types. One is primary or independent. Other one is associated with other diseases, just like doctor told now. So the treatment will be different. Purely different in these two situations. If it is secondary or referred only, we have to take the original disease seriously. And most often it may be some neurological problems, sometimes associated with sleeplessness and hypertension, or some even in psychiatric, some manasika conditions also, we will get the same symptom. So we have to isolate, we have to take a differential diagnosis first and do the treatment accordingly. If it is independent or swadantra yoga of the as a karna yoga, we have to concentrate in the treatment of that particular condition alone. For that, we have to consider that it is the seat of vata first, agash. So agash bodha and vata dosha. So we have to do the treatment accordingly. Mainly vata shamana treatment procedures. It should be done equally importantly in the ear and on the head. For that, shiro vasti and shiro abhyanga, shiro laban, shiro dhara, etc. should be selected according to the body constant of that patient and the clinical condition, etc. And in the locally in the ear, karnapura and karna abhyanga should be done, and mainly oral medication should be vata shamana. And the ghee in the night is the best choice. Sapna kale, after food, at bedtime, medicated ghee should be given. I have seen good effect in Dashamoola Grudha and Badradharvyadhi Gana Grudha, and even for with Gvidharyadhi. And side by side, milk should be taken as anupana. So for the daily practice, shiro abhyanga thailand should be selected. If so, if you're doing according to this theory, whether it is systemic, associated with a systemic disease or an independent one, first step, then treat accordingly. If it is no doubt, karnanadam will change it to deafness if left untreated. Nadova samubhetshita, it is the cause of badhirya. So we have to avoid being the patient deaf. For that, this treatment will be effective. Success rate is very high. That is my practical experience.
Yes, Dr. Thank you, ma'am.
Rajendra, yes. One more. Yes. Just I would like to add my experience here. She has told to all of us that it is one of the sign of the badhirya. Actually, what happens in the senile deafness, when the neurons are completely damaged, then deafness is there. But if the neurons are incompletely damaged, they may shout, and that shout is nothing but the tinnitus. So in case of tinnitus associated with the deafness, sensory neural deafness, especially of the old age, then it is due to the partial damage to these neurons. And just now, madam has explained that it is a part of deafness. So here, vata shamaka upchara should be done. And what she has pointed out, samanyam karna rogeshu ghratapanam rasayanam, what she has pointed out, ghee at the bedtime. What happened to in our practice, we used to give saptamrut loha with ghee to the patients of the age-related macular degeneration. And in follow-ups, after 1 or 2 months, when they came, elderly person, what they told? They told that we have got some improvement in our vision, what they were getting. But apart from that, our noises in the ears are reduced and our hearing is improved. So here it indicates that the Ghratapana is effective in Karna Roga, especially the degenerative type of or the senile deafness. Sure. Next, that is sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Related to this Karananada, there is one more question from the role of Marma Chikitsa in Karananada.
Sorry, I don't have any experience regarding Marma Chikitsa. Yes. So I won't be the authentic person to comment.
And same answer is from me also.
So this is from from Kusum Pandey, is our one of the delegate. Marma Chikitsa in Karananada. Yes, of course. Now to the next question. The treatment for the conjunctivitis. Please, ma'am.
Shanta Kumari madam is here with us, so let her comment on her subject.
Yes, of course. Please, ma'am. Please.
A treatment for conjunctivitis means, first of all, we have to analyze. I am always analyzing the any disease on the basis of doshas. So I will analyze the condition, whether it is Vata conjunctivitis or Pitta conjunctivitis or Kapha conjunctivitis. People will sometimes be thinking how it is possible. It is not a serious issue to have such a diagnosis. We have seen some patients having thick, very high-level discharges, sticky discharges in conjunctivitis. We have seen some other patients with the conjunctivitis with blood red conjunctiva and highly burning sensation and intolerance to light and running water. And there are other patients with pain by looking at objects and very little discharge like that. Do you think the same treatment can be done to all patients on the basis of the term conjunctivitis? No, that is my experience. So forever, this fit is thick and dense with edematous lids, it is a conjunctivitis. We need not go for a second diagnosis. We can do kabashamana, type of sega and astodhana, and even the parambada will be effective in that. And so that type, so vidalagam is prescribed in abhishanda chikitsa, that can be used, which is prescribed in kabaja abhishanda, that is seem to be useful. And for sega, kabashamana, dravya, trubala, yeshti, darvi, these all seem to be very effective. The sega can be done, and astodhana also accordingly. Kamsamana Asodhana can be done. If it is pitta dominant, the burning sensation and the bright light intolerance and redness, etc., there we can do pitta shamana sega with amla, usira, yeshti, like that we can select. Sadavari, these are very giving very good results. And for Asodhana also, Chandanadi, Arushiradi, this also can be done. It will give very good results. So take the condition on this basis, then do the treatment. Result is 100%. That is my experience.
Yes, sir. Answer, please.
Just now, madam has explained that we have to evaluate on the basis of doshas. But Trifala Kvatha Ashyotan or Trifala Kvatha Netra Dhavan, Daru Haridra Kvatha Netra Dhavan. If the redness is much and pitaja lakshanas are much more, inflammation is much more, you can add somewhat lodra into the tripala kvatha. If and you can add some very little camphor to the ashyotana to give soothing results. So tripala and nishadi kvatha or the daru haridra kvatha or can be added, even milk can be added into that. And previous, so these are the simple ashyotanas we can make with the simple daru haridra, trifala, and very little camphor. You can add lodra into that. That will be effective in viral conjunctivitis. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Shanta Kumari, ma'am, please treatment for the short sight and general eye care.
That's a very vast topic.
Vast question.
Yes.
Vast question. It cannot be limited to one or two sentences. And generally speaking, short sight, everybody know, which is there is some anatomical this involvement. The curvature may be more and the anteroposterior length will be more. And there will be some changes in the constitution of or structural changes in the vitreous humor or lens. Like that, it varies. So that is why it is progressive up to 18 years. And this treatment is always mechanical correction with the lens like that. I have seen patients who believing that when we say lens, it is a glass piece, just like they study in physics. But it is not that. We have to first of all bring to mind that this is a live cells having its own metabolism and a nourishment and like that. So any medicine will act on it. We can change the position, we can change the curvature, we can change the distance by medicinal treatments. That is my view. I used to do like that. So we have to consider the what I can say, the elasticity and the flexibility of the muscles of the ocular system first, so that the accommodation will be possible. For that, this type of eye exercise, that should be very scientific and formulated according to that patient. All exercise for everybody is not a solution. For astigmatism, for a young boy, or a pure physiological myopia, a patient of 15 years, that is different. Like that, I have taken so many these devices for this exercise, different patterns and different devices for exercise in my hospital. And so the three steps I will take, one is oral medications to improve the strength and the nervous capacity, functional capability of the eye. For that, Jivandhyadikritam or Tribulakritam or the special churnas, Rasayana churnas, even Brahmi kritam, these are effective. And second is to increase the the elasticity and other flexibility of the muscles, so that the movement will be ready and accommodation is possible at any distance in any range. For that, very scientific level treatment procedures are to be done, like shirovasti, shirolabhanam, or shirodhara, netra tarpanam, etc. That also varies from patient to patient. And then comes these two, three things. One is exercises. We have to practice only after attaining these properties of the muscles normal, we can start the exercise. Otherwise, what will happen, once they stop the exercise, the improvement also will be stopped. Sometimes it will go back. So bring the muscle power or the accommodative power of with the tendons and nerves and strong enough, then start the exercise. This is the basic theory for the treatment of short sight. So we need not wait up to 18 years to have a LASIK treatment. We can do it then itself. And one more thing, we have to be very careful. It may be a degenerative type myopia. So it should be taken seriously. It will go even after the maturity or even after 18 years or 17 years of age, it will increase. Then we have to continue the medicines. And Rasayana Chikitsa will be more important in that stage. That depends on the clinical condition and clinical stage of that patient. So nausea will not be a main thing in that stage. I have seen patients being blind just because nausea by an Ayurvedic doctor. And so nausea is important treatment in short sight, and they're doing it in a degenerative type of myopia, and the retina was detached. So be careful when handle a degenerative or pathological myopia. For that, Rasayana treatment is absolutely necessary. Netra tarpanam, these oral medications, and these murdha thailas, etc. should be selected. That is my advice.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. There is another question. As a post COVID anosmia treatment for the post COVID anosmia long term from 4 to 6 months, history of 4 to 6 months.
In anosmia, if we take it as a function of vata, snehan anasya should be given according to my opinion. Rest experts can comment.
Just as I was a part of COVID coordinating team here at Government Ayurvedic College Nanded, it was a symptom of a COVID disease, loss of taste and even loss of smell, etc. So these may be the viral damages to the not only to the mucous membrane, but away from that it may be some to the neural part also. So I think time is only treatment, and just Kunjal Bhatt madam has suggested that Vata Shamak Upchar Brahmanasya can be given.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, one question is there. I'm sharing the image of that question, so
okay,
it will be easy for us to see. Yeah, is it visible, the image?
Yes, visible. Please, ma'am, sir.
So, partial removal of tongue and the edema is there. This was a cancer patient and plastic surgery has been done, and the edema gives irritation and distortion of the face. So, 3/4 tongue has been removed.
There is lower lip edema, madam. Edema on lower lip.
Yes,
and even edema on face also. Madam, this is the complication of the removal of the lymph nodes. Okay. What were draining. Yes, yes. Okay. It is obstruction to the lymphatics because of the removal of the lymph nodes. The Dr. lymphatic
Vandana,
channel...
Do you want to ask exactly, ma'am? Aap puchiye, Dr. Vandana?
Aapne question puchiye. Namaskar, sir. Madam Kumari, Thade sir, aur jo organizers hain, सभी को नमस्ते. तो ये क्वेश्चन मेरा है और मैंने इमेज भेजा कि वो होस्ट है, तो मैं इंटरवेंशन ऑफ आयुर्वेदा जानना चाह रही थी कि अगर ये लिम्फेटिक्स का ऑक्लूजन है तो क्या हम उसकी जी सर, इसके ऊपर आप कमेंट करिए प्लीज.
यस यस, प्लीज गिव योर ओपिनियंस. ऑल द डिग्निफाइड पर्सनालिटीज. खान सर,
जस्ट 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 आई एम थिंकिंग मैडम.
या
एक्चुअली इट इज
या
एक्चुअली इट इज एनाटॉमिकल डिफॉर्मिटी मैडम. द मेनी टाइम्स आफ्टर द ऑन्को सर्जरीज द रिमूवल ऑफ द लिम्फ नोड्स व्हिच आर सपोज्ड टू बी द कैरिंग सेकेंडरीज. So those lymph nodes are removed, and such edema on the even half of the face is the most of the time complication. So, but here in the case at the glossectomy, anterior 2/3 glossectomy is done already. So tongue carries the lymphatics on the both sides, both submandibular, jugulodigastic and the jugular chain. So it is necessary for in case of CA tongue to remove bilateral lymphatics, madam. So it happened that the bilateral submandibular lymph node, which is the major lymph node in the Chalukya, and some of the jugular chain, they are removed. So the lower half of the face have lost the channel of the lymphatics. Madam, what happens? That these lymphatics direct drain is that drainage channel is lost because of the loss due to surgery removal of the because of the removal of the lymph nodes. What happens? These lymphatic fluid move as interstitial fluid and go into the region of draining area of the other lymphatics, and that is drained from there. So I think it is the only time taking event. After much of the time, it may be some 6 months, 1 year or 2 year. or it may be persisting. But only Svedana can be done. Only Svedana can be done to make excessive movement of the fluids so that the edema can be reduced. Nothing more can be done, madam.
Thank you, sir. आपने उसकी संप्राप्ति पूरी बता दी और बता भी दिया कि क्यों ये हुआ. We asked number of times, so they just said कि ये post op complications होते ही हैं. But स्वेदन करते हैं तो स्वेदन जब हम करेंगे तो कुछ कोई डेफिनेट उसमें हर्ब्स डालनी है, जड़ी बूटी डाल के तब स्वेदन कराएं तो बेटर रिजल्ट आएंगे क्या?
सैंधव जल स्वेदन विल बी गुड मैडम.
ओके थैंक यू.
Sir, one more question is repeatedly asked by Dr. Prabhat, sir. Oral lichen.
Wow, it is very tough condition, madam. but it can be treated on the. It can be raktamokshana can be done. It can be done treated as it is a systemic disease, madam. Oral lichen is very tough to treat, and many times patients are steroid dependent when they come to us. So it is tough, but again, on general principles of the Mukha Roga, by various gandushas and systemic anulomana, it can be controlled. What I would like to tell.
Any other, ma'am? Shanta Kumari, ma'am?
This type of cases, we have to get a detailed case history. Simply saying something is not a good thing, I think. Because we have to consider the dosha pragriti of that patient. And in many cases, it seems to be an avarana case. Most often, vata and the kapha. So after getting a detailed history of that particular patient, I can suggest a treatment.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it will be incomplete.
Yeah, definitely. Yes.
General procedures can be done just like a kapala dandosha, etc., etc. But for a perfect treatment, all the details are necessary.
Oh yes, of course, ma'am.
Okay. So another question is there from Dr. Seema, that what will be the frequency of Karnapuran? Whether it is done at a daily basis or sometimes, what will the duration, exact duration?
Karnapurana can be done not as a regular practice. Before that, we have to do Snehana Karma and Svedana like that. And I used to do it for 7 days at a course. And after that, Karna Abhyanga can be done, not Karnapurana. Karna Abhyanga can be done daily. Shirasravana Padeshu, Abhyanga Majare Nityam. So then Shirasravana Padeshu Tam Visheshana Chile. So that can be done. Abhyanga can be done as a daily practice. And this Karna Puranam, not as a daily practice. As a part of a systemic pakka treatment only, we can do that.
Yeah, definitely. Yes. Another one question is there by Dr. Sushmita. How to prepare Ashwatthana, Madam Kunjal, ma'am? Aapke liye hai, shayad, with one example.
Ashwatthana, as such, if we want to prepare it from Kwath or Swarasa, as per the yoga mentioned in classic, you just prepare the medicine, leave it for a sedimentation, and then you just pass it through the filter paper and funnel. And you'll get a clear solution of that, and then you can use it for Ashwatthana. And if you are using any grit for Ashwatthana, so just lip on the grit and put the drops into the eye. So if you are using Sneha, no need to go for anything else. But if you are using the Swarasa Rasakriya or a Kwath type of preparation, then you have to filter it to avoid the particles of that particular drug.
Thank you. There is one another question. Triphala drop preparation, which is explained by the Dhiman sir. Any dignities, please, if you know. Triphala drop with honey.
on just on last month in end of the August, we had 6 days a CME at our place, and sir has come as a resource person, and he demonstrated the method of preparing this Ashwatthan. As I mentioned, that prepare the quath. I just told the method he has told us in last month. So the method I told was suggestion of Dr. Dhiman sir. The method is the same: prepare it, leave it for sedimentation, just filter it, and then you can use it. And yeah, but the question of shelf life remains there. Better to use a fresh one. Don't use the prepared one, because we are not using any preservative or any other thing. So better to use fresh one, and there will be no issue of any contamination.
One thing to be added, one problem with the shelf life you have mentioned, that can be solved by the arka preparations.
Yeah, definitely. Yes.
That is very effective. Anything can be used in arka preparation, tribala, lodra, whatever it may be. And shelf life is more than 1 year.
Sir, but in case of arka, so, only volatile substances will come into the arka. Not water, all water soluble substances. Here with the kwatha in Ashwatthana, or water soluble substances are also expected in to act there. In arka, what will happen? Only volatile substances will come. So arka will be totally different. You can have a good shelf life, but it will not be same to the kwatha.
But there are so many arka preparation mentioned in the arka prakasha.
Yes, yes.
And that material can be used. And
yes, yes.
So many chakshushya dravyas are in that to solve this problem. That is what I mentioned.
Okay, okay.
Yeshti, madhu, dharvi, etc. comes under that group. So enough and more chakshushya dravyas are in will come. In that chapter itself.
What Dhiman sir has now just now told, that Trifala Kwatha, in Trifala Kwatha, honey should be added. Here I would like to add that the honey is a good preservative. But what happens, the honey what we are getting from market is 99% impure. We are not sure, even from very good pharmacies. They have failed to pass the test for the this one. So in case of honey, you would like to add, for specially for the eye drop, you have to take from the good source at the village level, take it in front of you, extracted it, and get stored in your clinic, and use that only. Don't take a market preparation honey, packed honey, for the ophthalmic practice. It's my practice, what I do.
That is the case not only with the honey, it so many other things also.
But we have to specially take care for the honey, because yes, it is 99% impure. Yes.
What about Siddha and this sarkara or honey and even water? Even water, if we go it for testing in the lab, and water from well or water from, I am facing that problem always. That is why we have a GMP manufacturing unit, and when testing all the pure water from well or from the bore well or from the
spring section,
everything happens. The same thing happens with the honey also. So if we have to good result, the medicine should be pure.
Yes,
and
yes.
Quality maintenance is the main problem. The biggest problem in the manufacturing section. And the two main problems, one is this quality to get the pure thing. Second is it's a shelf life, especially in this ophthalmic practice.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you for adding. Dr. Shilpa, madam, and Dr. Rajendra Dhate, please give permit to leave. because I have got another.
About to say that it's a long discussion. So thank you very much, all of you.
Yes, sir, we have already taken your valuable time, sir.
Yeah, sir. Yeah, yeah. Definitely, Dr. Shanta Kumari, ma'am, to bahut busy thi, but still she has given a lot of time. So thank you very much, all the highly qualified discussion, I think, and it's really a good discussion today. So all of you had done a very great job. Thank you very much, all the viewers, all the speakers. And at the last of the session, I would like to call upon Dr. Naveen Joshi, sir, who is the founder of this platform, Archdarpan. And sir, there is one question also for you. What is the role of Marma in Karnanada? If you can.
The role of Marma
expert. And yes, he teaches Marma very well. So I request
to answer. There is a Vidur Marma, and the Vidur Marma as a Snayu Marma, it is very, very effective in Karnanada. So you can just give pressure with your thumb on the mastoid process 15 to 18 times. It will be beneficial, but not only through this Vidur Marma. You also have to stimulate the Ans Marma also. So it is very, very effective. So thank you, Dr. Silpa Irmeji, Dr. Kunjal Bhatji, and Dr. Dhiman sir, and many of the dignity, which I am just looking, the Shalakya Tantra. This is a very beautiful a webinar and on therapeutic procedures in Shalakya Tantra. Chairman of the session, I thanks to Dr. Vaidya K. Santa Kumari ji and moderator Vaidya Rajendra Dhate ji, and from the whole of the team of the Ayush Darpan, and special thanks to Vaidya Silpa Irme ji for organizing such a good event on Ayush Darpan platform on the occasion of the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav program, as this series will be continue up to the National Ayurveda Day. So thank you. Thanks to all of you.
So thank you very much, all of you. And namaskar. Take care. Bye-bye. Good day. Good day. Thank you.
So thank you very much. The all the respected dignity.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Moderator, sir, thank you very much for your time.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank
you. It was really nice session to be connected with you all. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Have a nice day.
Yeah, definitely, ma'am. Thank you.